When we walk into the room, it's a standing room only situation, so thank you all for coming and being a part of this conversation and discussion today. We are going to give our speaker a little bit of an introduction, but I know one thing we want to emphasize is this is a conversation and a discussion, probably more than we would say a talk. So definitely, and be a part of the conversation. So, I'm Kate Ford. I work in the English Philosophy Department. I'm also the Associate Director of the Ethics Center. And I wanted to thank the Ethics Center as well as the program, Professional Communication Program, for being co-sponsors for the event. I want to thank the foundation as well for helping provide snacks, which are back in that corner. I'm trying to hide them from you. After the discussion, you can feel free to have some snacks before you head out. But just to give kind of a background for this presentation, as we all know, the topic of fake news, it's in the air, right? It's always something that you're hearing about lately, and I really wanted our campus to be able to have an opportunity to talk about it. And I happened to remember to connect with a colleague that I had both in professional journalism and in the journalism education at Minnesota. And I connected with Chris Ison, who is a former editor from the Minneapolis Star Tribune and is presently at University of Minnesota in the School of Journalism and Mass Communications there teaching. And he's just co-authored a textbook on media ethics. And he's the perfect person to kind of have this conversation with to talk about the different issues in journalism, journalistic ethics, topics of fake news, and communication, and mass communication in media. And so when I connected with him, he'd already been talking about this at other universities and other forums as well. So he's definitely connected with a lot of different perspectives. And different people with different interests in this area have kind of this broad range of experience in journalism, but also kind of talking about these issues. So, I'll hand it over to Chris.
Thanks, what a crowd. Are you in the class tonight? Anything but class, right? You even come to this. Thanks for having me. When Kate asked me to come, yes, I looked at my calendar. I had a little bit of a crazy week, and I immediately said, for UW-Stout, absolutely. Because I know that this is a great school. I tried to get my daughter to come here, but it's a full school. So I've been paying for that for many years now. It's a great campus. I've known people who've gone. So thanks for coming. This is a hot topic right now. Jump in anytime you want.
Can we up the mic a little bit? Thank you.
Page for So this is it is a hot topic, and I'll go through some stuff, some thoughts about it, and some context I think that hopefully will be interesting or maybe even helpful. And so feel free to ask questions as we go, and I'll be sure to leave plenty of time afterwards so we can just talk about whatever you want to talk about, which could be this or some of the related issues that have come up with the media and the president and anything you guys want to talk about in fair game as far as I'm concerned. So here we go. This was a story in the New York Sun in 1835. Some of you, if you read Columbia Journalism Review, they did a little thing on this, so thanks to them. This was a series of six stories that they ran. Based on a person, a scientist, who done a telescopic review, gazing of the moon over many, 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 many weeks, and found life on the moon, all kinds of great life on the moon.
Unicorns.
As it says, several new specimens of animals of white or gray color, and triangular temples. That was false. You might have guessed by now. Turns out it was a hoax. They put it in there. It was the age of the penny press when more newspapers were selling to a mass audience, and whatever they would read would make them a lot of money. And this did very, very well for them. 50 years later or so, the New York Herald did a story about wild animals terrorizing the city that had been broken loose from the Central Park, I think the zoo or the museum there. Not true. They actually said that in the very bottom of this long, long story, all of this is made up. So they were just having fun, but of course, who reads to the end of stories, right? Even the short ones. So a lot of people were hysterical about this, and it wasn't true at all. Moving forward a little bit, of course, we have the tabloids, right? Didn't know we were going to cover this kind of fake news. But of course, you know, it's that or that child. We love that child. I guess we did. They ran a lot of that child stories. We can decide whether or not we individually think those were true. But they seem harmless. But then, right, we have the tabloids running this kind of stuff a lot. Right? And this actually became part of the campaign. This question about whether Ted Cruz is linked to the JFK assassination. No, of course, there's nothing to suggest that that would be true, and but it was used, and my guess is, given that the National Enquirer is one of the really top-selling newspapers in America, or publications, should we call it, a lot of people probably decided to say it was true, or whatever they were thinking, right? Some of you might remember that for years the Bush administration was quietly paying columnists and television pundits to promote his agenda, sometimes on his marriage initiative, sometimes on his education reform and other things. People didn't know that, at least for a while. When they did, a lot of those people lost their syndication or their credibility, certainly. Fake news, being paid to promote it, hard to say. If you really believe it, if you're being paid to promote it, certainly violates almost every standard of most mainstream media, which is why these people got in trouble for it. I don't know. More recently, we have these sites that a lot of them are aggregators and use others' news. Some of them do a little of their own, but use others' headlines and then drive you to a site. This is one called Go Minnesota. It used to be called Bring Me the News. I believe this one's owned by the Polack. And you see these stories. They're all stories, but this one says advertising. And then this one over here, I don't know if you can see it, but in small type here says sponsored. It's got this little group of Craigans. And if you click on that, you think you're going to read a news story about the best cure for spring fever or like a feature story or something. It's actually promotional copy for Craigans resort, and it's kind of related to what we call native advertising, brand journalism. There's a lot of different terminology that we use for it. Personally, frankly, to avoid saying advertisement, because people want to read news and they think it's more credible, and so everybody tries to get away from calling it advertising, but it's really advertising or promotional material made to look like news. Is that fake news? The traditional mainstream media has had its own role in this. This is a auto section from my old newspaper, the Star Tribune. Kind of typical auto section, but you know, in some ways it looks like a news page. Not exactly though, there are some differences. You usually wouldn't have a photo sticking into the column like this, but it's got your headline, it's got what looks like stories, and of course we used to have our own auto critic, you know, the guy who the dealers would loan the most, the nicest cars on the lot, you know, to critique against a lot of bad critiques, but once in a while, but you never see it in here. You never see a bad critique in here, and why is that? Well, it's not written by real, it's not for people to determine whether or not they should buy that car. It's created to sell more cars. And if you look up here at the top, it says, in light gray, I don't even know if you can see it, but it says, produced by Star Tribune Specialty Publications Group. We all know what that is, right? Actually, I worked there for 18 years. I don't know what that is. I think it's the advertising department. I'm pretty sure it's the advertising. The idea was to obscure what this was. Is it journalism? Is it advertising? What is it? And that's an old page. Of course, now we have stuff like this. This one happens to say ad content by Taboola. We see that all the time at the bottom of websites. These are ads. And it says ad content. Banks urge homeowners to switch to a 15-year mortgage, et cetera, right? That's the Green Bay Press Gazette for you Packers fans and me. This is same day, San Diego Union Tribune. One of the same ads. And it says homeowners to a 15-year fixed, right? It's the same thing. This one says, you can barely read it, sponsored links by Taboola. So they call their sponsored links. The other one called their advertising. Which is it? Same stuff. Exact same stuff, right? We're calling it a different thing. Trust me. Newsrooms and ad departments have arguments about this stuff. About what to call this thing. Here's the Star Tribune. They call theirs sponsored links. Sponsored links by Taboola. I think that same mortgage piece is in this one. Blue Apron was hot that day. Blue Apron automated ad was really hot that day, at least on my site. Again, sponsored links. My guess is a lot of you know what sponsored links means now. You know what sponsored links means? It's paid, it's an ad. I don't know if my mom knows what sponsored links means, and she's doing it a lot, right? The point is, often we don't know, and then pretty soon you have sponsored links by Taboola, and they have stuff like this. This is a Hillary Clinton ad, so it starts to get political, right? You read a news story or an ad or what? There's a tip-off and it says, say you were with her. It makes it look like a promotional material, right? lot of cars. This one is right next to it, and these look like kind of feature news or something, variety news, right? And then we have another one here. This is a promotion news, but then it does say ads. I don't quite read it very well. It's funny how that works. And Hillary rigged the 2016 election. Well, that's certainly important news. Goodness sakes. I didn't know that. That is an ad, but it's also fake news. And then you have the pure fake news that we all kind of probably came to touch with, you know, which are totally made up things to and made to look like it came from a news site that people create to drive, in the case of the political stuff, ads, like-minded people to their website so that they're selling more ads and get more money for their ads, and they come on Facebook, and as passive viewers of Facebook, people say, some studies show 45 or so percent of people get some of their news from Facebook. It's been started to suggest most of them get their news from Facebook, and that's not quite what research shows, so they get some. But a lot of people, right? It just comes across and they click on it and don't pay a lot of attention to where it came from. And this is the stuff that's driving a lot of people crazy. But you can kind of see how we got it. I think the mainstream media has a role in this. Frankly, I don't know if it's worth admitting it or not. They've got to fix the bigger problem. But it's kind of interesting to see the iterations, I think, of kind of deception. It can affect brands, right? Pepsi had a little problem during the campaign where Trump supporters were going to boycott Pepsi because of a fake news report that the Pepsi CEO said something bad about. Fake news. McDonald's had to deal with a fake news piece that said all their stores were going to close. So people in the PR industry have to learn how to deal with fake news and be on the watch for it at all times too. And then we have things like, you know, trying not to get partisan and political here, but we have stuff like Breitbart, which has done a lot of writing about how everybody else does fake news, but to be perfectly honest, a lot of their stuff is in my opinion. Certainly disagree with that, but I don't know. Is there stuff fake news? We can talk about that. Yeah.
I had a question about, you mentioned how in the 1800s the paper intention was to write stuff that was false. Their intention was to get people to read something that they call money. Is that the same goal today? Because I want to know what makes it good, you know, a good topic for effective technique. So what is their goal when they're writing today?
You're way ahead of me. You're a little ahead of me. It's a great point. There are different reasons for doing it, as we know. The big ones we've seen is creating false information that you think people will click on so you can sell ads and make more money off of advertising, right? It's purely for profit. We saw people from, Macedonia creating fake news sites for American, doing the U.S. election and making $10,000 a month. All kinds of people. We heard, saw people interviewed who said they actually don't like Trump, but they knew that that they could create fake news that was pro-Trump and it would get traded around a lot, and they could make a lot of money out of it, and did. So that's false information for profit, deliberately false information for profit. And then there's false information for purely partisan reasons, which is making stuff up just to drive public opinion in favor of one person or against one person, right? And then I listened to distant cousins here with, I would argue, some sponsored content because it's created look like news, but it's not. And you have to be pretty smart to figure it out. And we are starting to figure it out because we see so much of it now, and you get conditioned to it and learn about it. But at first, especially, it was created to deceive. And it's still a little bit, in my view, created to deceive. If it wasn't, they'd just say, hey, advertise. Here's an ad. Right? You could argue partisan content that is made to look like nonpartisan reporting is fake news. It's at least deceptive, dishonest. Right? That key value of transparency is lost. Right? This is what we're here for. We're not trying to fool anybody. You could argue, in maybe a slightly different way, that's fake news too. You could also argue that, you know, the person, the blogger in mom's basement, God love them, some of them are actually really good journalists, but some of them just are wannabes and don't really have any particular talent and no training and don't try that hard and put out stuff that they didn't do good citizen journalism. Is that fake news? I don't know. Kind of. Why would we be surprised, you know, with at the fact that people are confused? The Pew Center determined that a large number of Americans are confused, and almost a quarter of them say they have shared fake news either inadvertently or deliberately in recent times. And of course, should be no surprise that Americans' trust in the mass media has been underperformed. I think we're still ahead of used car dealers. I don't mean to use other used car dealers. Just above Congress. Oh, it's getting close. Just above Congress. So we've got trouble out there. But here's the thing. That number is for mass media. And as always, the big question is, what media are we talking about, right? There is so much media out there. The one thing I keep finding myself asking people is when they're either critical or they're just talking about media is which media, right? Because we've got all kinds. We've got bloggers and we've got partisan media and we've got, you know, media and you know, Blaze and BuzzFeed and Inquirer and the Star Tribune and the New York Times and Fox News and all those, right? And the Stoutonians. A lot of new nonprofit websites. And of course, TV news, where most people still get the news. And 24-hour news sources. So they're not all the same. And they have different standards and different norms and different resources and a lot of work in these different schools. So we've got to be careful. So what do we do? What are ways to deal with this? For readers and viewers and listeners, it's the hardest time. We know how complicated it is. We know how hard it is to understand if the Affordable Care Act is actually lowering healthcare costs or not, and for whom. right? That's hard stuff. And there's so much media out there coming at us from all these directions, virtually all of them saying they're the best. If you're a passive member of the audience, it's impossible. You just have to be active and vigilant about how you pick your news. CNN did news, some of them are out there, and some of them are just out there with everybody. But some little tips for audience members, you know, figure out if the story comes from some weird URL, you know, that you've never heard of. That's a good little thing. None of these do it all, but there are little things that you can do to be more proactive and things to put in the show. Is anybody else reporting the story? If nobody else is, or only a very certain kind of partisan organization reporting it, you should probably be a little careful. Sometimes headlines say one thing, but to get your attention, to get a message across, but the story doesn't really show up, right? That's a tip-off. Good media, news media organizations don't do that. Do they cite primary sources? How are their sources? Always something to look at. Now, people can make up, you know, a fake news site can make up sources. Legit sources can just say they got them, but you know, a lot of fake news just doesn't have good primary sources. A lot of fake news takes old stories and repurposes them, so in today's context, they look a lot different. They have a different message. So if it's not dated, that's a tip-off. And if it's old and showing up now, that's a tip-off. Sometimes supporting photos are just grabbed off the web and are a tip-off to what's a fake news. Always think about, are you more accepting or rejecting because the story doesn't fit your preconceived point of view, especially in politics. Are we quick to pass along a story because we agree with it? That's what these places bank on. Or do we automatically reject it because it doesn't fit with our point of view? That alone isn't a good reason to reject it. We should do the other things. Because if reliable facts are contrary to our point of view, we probably should consider that, right, as intellectually honest people. That's important. Has it been debunked by the fact checkers? There are a lot of fact checkers out there. I'll show you a few. But to me, those are becoming one of the most important little cottage industries in the news media business, is the fact-checking organizations. And those folks are good. Sorry to say that, I'm going to find out that some bogus organization is starting their own fact. They probably have, and I don't know about it. But I do want to know about that. The ones we've heard about are pretty darn good. And consider how the story is written in the tone and use common sense, you know? If it's a big screed, you know, that probably should tip you off, right? That it's you know, super partisan. If we read enough good, legit news, we can sometimes tell the difference. Sometimes I read some, fake news, or highly partisan news that's trying not to be partisan and has a lot of baloney in it. And they're just poorly done. Not all, but those are some steps. Think about the news organizations that you believe in. What are they here for? Do you think they are there to help inform you, or are they trying to persuade you? There's nothing wrong with good opinion journalism, but you should know what it is and when you're reading. Do you know that they have a track record of hiring trained journalists? Because believe it or not, I know you expect a story from having a Ballroom school. There are good new sites too, but if you stop and think about it, I'm going to tell you what my point is, but think about the complaints about a lot of the mainstream media today. You know, that's the same mainstream media whose people are getting killed in war zones, you know, who are out there in the middle of the night covering the murder down the streets. So, and doing all kinds of great work about social problems and social justice and all this stuff that we really appreciate on the one hand. And then when it gets to politics, we assume they're all a bunch of dishonest, lying, cheating scumbags. Like, does that really fit? I don't think it does. I don't think it does. Don't get me started. Does it differentiate between news and opinion? Is it transparent? Do you know, does it label stuff? This is new. Do we have a code of ethics? I know you got to do a little checking on that kind of stuff. That's not a bad thing to check on. I'll talk more about that in a second. Does it do things like correct errors? It never corrects errors? No. In my mind, on its face, not worth dealing with. Does it explain itself once in a while, especially when it deals with controversial stuff? Right? Do you get to hear from editors about why they do things and if that makes sense? The New York Times, you know, had columnists and others explaining how they make a decision about this issue of whether to say Donald Trump lied or whether Donald Trump said something in which there is no evidence, for which there is no evidence, you know, or how they say it. Other institutions explain that. Reuters News Service has explained how it expects its reporters to cover things in the Trump era, and it made that statement public. Explain themselves. NPR has written a piece on their take on whether to call say that Donald Trump has lied or use other language and why they take a different position than the New York Times. Both have a thoughtful position, but different positions. Right? And if you don't know some of this stuff, if you don't have a decent feeling you can trust them, don't pass it on. Right? I'm going to finish. I mentioned fact checkers. Snopes has a guide to fake news sites if you ever want to look. Not a bad thing. Scan it, and then every once in a while when you see something come up, you'll know. I think that's worthwhile. Factcheck.org is one of the really good fact checkers, and they'll do running time fact checks during, you know, the presidential debates, and especially on political stuff, obviously. They do really good fact-checking, and they have some nice information on how to spot fake news. PolitiFact does the famous pants on fire. They have the scale from totally truthful to half-truth to mostly false to pants on fire. You know, when I watched the debates this year, I always had PolitiFact up at the same time. Fascinating. And they keep a running tab and keep all their stuff accessible. And, you know, nonpartisan, they catch Democrats and Republicans and everybody's trying to get in on this and do a better job. This is some real down context. It's a Twitter account from Washington Post. And they will bring context to all of the president's tweets. There's a service we thought we'd never see. And, you know, they don't just say, we're just going to tell you when Donald Trump's tweets are false. Why? They put things into context. There's a lot of gray area in a lot of things. So those are just some good ones.
And that's from the Post, Washington?
That's from the Washington Post, yep. Yep. Actually, it only turned out that late. I haven't seen a lot, but I've seen some. And then I think you should ask yourself, this is kind of a philosophical journalism thing, if you can figure out what the motivations of news sources, your sources of news are, and I just think this is of vital importance to our country today. Be too grandiose about it. But, you know, we should understand what I think, or decide if we agree with what journalism should be for. And there's a group of journalists who came together probably 18 years ago now or so, called the Committee of Concerned Journalists. They became affiliated with the Pew Center for media and the press, and they have stuff on the Reynolds Center site now too. They came together and all this many years ago and decided that the media was straying a bit. This was before all the social media stuff. And they all came together and came up with what they felt was kind of a statement of shared purpose for journalism. And I love it, and that's why I put it up here. And I think I tell all my students, you got to know what you're here for. You know, that's where you make good news decisions. And that's what inspires you. It's a good purpose. That's what energizes you to do good work and to care about it and realize it's not about you. And it said the central purpose of journalism is to provide citizens with accurate and reliable information they need to function in a free society. Which, if you think about it, it puts the focus on citizens making good choices, not on any political party, not on any cause, particular cause. It's about the public. It's about giving the public the information they need to be empowered in this democracy. Right? If you buy that as a journalist or as a journalism student, if you buy that, it's gonna dictate how you go about your work. Because it's about who you're doing it for. And that's gonna affect how you do it. To me, we don't know that journalism is supposed to be for. But stating it and keeping your eye on that mission, I think, is vitally important. It's also incredibly energizing because good journalism is really hard work. Good journalism. That's why a lot of fake news sites are fake. It's too hard. The real stuff is hard. It's pretty easy to make junk up, right? But if you know it's for this kind of cause, to me it's very energizing. And you don't mind them. You're doing something that's bigger than you. So if you can determine somehow that's part of what they do, that's great. There's a lot of talk now about, and I'm about done, about better media literacy in schools. That we really need better media literacy in, some would say, grade school, high school, and college. You know, about looking at sources, at primary sources, making good judgments about what's good. What or who is a good source, what kind of information is written in a way that's biased or not, how to tell the difference, what the news media is supposed to do, what it should, things like that. So there's Stony Brook now has a new MOOC they're developing for media literacy. A lot of individual schools are starting to push classes in media literacy. There's a bill in California to require more media literacy in its curriculum. You know, all that seems to make sense, right? We want people to be good readers and viewers and smart about how they get their information. And all sides should be in favor of something. Journalists. I think journalists need to not get caught up in partisan stuff. I don't care if they're mad about what Donald Trump says about them. You know, we ought to buy about that stuff. We say that stuff about journalists all the time. These days, but you know, and I think we need to remain objective. Some people think that's a bad word. It probably is. It's a word we use a lot. It's not really meant to mean we're robots and don't have opinions, that we see, you know, everything back the same. It's not really meant that way in journalism. We probably should be a better word in some areas. What it really is supposed to mean is that we gather and report news based on fact and evidence, not based on personal bias, advocacy, self-interest, things like that. That we treat reporting more like a science. We gather the facts and we let the facts tell the story and lead us in the direction that they lead us. But it doesn't mean that, you know, we see every fact as carrying equal weight or anything like that. So we can read a lot more about that. And understand more, a lot written about it. We have a little bit of a problem, I think, sometimes in that some people don't treat their social media, some journalists don't treat their social media the same way, and it suggests a bias, and that just hurts our credibility. That's an issue. We should be very transparent in how we report. We should explain when we don't know something that's crucial to a story. We should name our sources whenever possible. Sometimes you can't. But we should do as well as we can. And it should be the rare exception when we don't. We should correct our mistakes. We should let the public in on how we do our work, so they can judge it better. And what we find in journalism, some, you know, anecdotally on controversial stories when people are really mad at us, is when we explain ourselves a lot of times and why we did things, people are kind of go, oh, I see. That makes more sense. Because they don't get that person. And why would they? They don't have to spend time in newsrooms. I mean, they've got other jobs to do, so you've got to understand it. If you want people to trust you, you got to explain how you do it. We should be better at distinguishing between news and ad content. actually, a guy named Tom Rosensteel, he's a great writer. He and Bill Kovach wrote The Elements of Journalism, a great book about journalism. Practice and ethics. He has written about this. We need to be very clear about that. So that one was mine. This one was Tom Rosenstein. And he makes a great point. Clearly distinguishing between news and opinion or analysis, which we don't always do online as well as we used to in print. Sometimes you call up a story and you start to read it and go, it's like an editorial. And it is. But if it's not clear, it sounds like, you know, you're what we think of as a legitimate, responsible mainstream media site suddenly is all opinionated. And it's not that usually or often. It's just that they didn't label it well on the web. And you need to be better about that. And we have to keep explaining when people don't tell the truth when they're in positions of power, and that takes some guts and it takes resources to be on those stories and to have the reporters who are good enough to do it and that we have enough of those reporters, because as we know, it's these days it goes on at 3 a.m. too, all the time, right? And this is about the last thing. I think that the legitimate, I keep saying the legitimate responsible, have a fantastic story to tell that most people don't know. And we can, and this goes to the whole transparency, we can be, have a better conversation with the audience. We can, I say we, I'm not really in it anymore, I just can't help it. Editors can do more of these online chats and explain themselves with readers. And I think when they do that, they find it fascinating. They learn, the editors learn something, and I think the readers do too. They do it every once in a while, they should do it more. We could write more columns about how we approach a certain story, or how, and talk about how people are explaining how they're covering the Trump administration, because that's what they go through, of course. And clear about that so people understand it. We used to have ombudsmen or readers' representatives at a lot of the big newspapers, and some in radio, the public radio stations, and some TV. A lot of those have gone away with budget cuts, but they were the people who were tasked with reaching out to the public and listening to them, hearing their concerns, hearing what they think. Now we can do that a lot more by reading comments and getting emails and stuff. But they also made sure that we were correcting our errors in the newsroom. And they would write a column now and then on something to help explain how the newsroom works. I'll never forget, many years ago, a guy at Star Tribune, before I ever worked there, wrote a piece about how the newsroom operates on election night, which was fascinating to me. And it gives you a little insight into the hard work that goes on and how precise it is, and how much time has been prepared, and how seriously they take it. And they can write about a lot of things that give people some insight into how it does work. And we can publish our ethics codes, and I throw the New York Times ethic code up here, which is more than 10,000 words, actually. And it's public, and it's a fascinating document, and covering everything from whether they can have a school board candidate's lawn sign, or use a parking pass they got from City Hall, or accept food in the press box, or cheer in the press box, or all different kinds of things. And I have this guy, I teach this ethics class at the University of Minnesota. And it's mostly non-journalists, anybody can take it. And early on when we start to talk about journalism, we talk about advertising, PR too, but get that out of the way and get to the good stuff. Early on talking about journalism, I'll ask, what all you think about the mainstream media? And, hands will go up, and, you got to know what their bias is, because they all have a bias. Some people are more terrible, but as long as you know that, there are a couple of good ones out there. And things like that, very discouraging. And then we spend the rest of the semester going through codes of ethics and basic journalism values that most journalists get, responsible news organizations hold, and what you can't do and how they go about their job. Inevitably, some people towards the end will say, gee, it sounds like you can't be a citizen if you're a journalist. Everything's a conflict of interest. This whole trying to remain neutral and independent and nonpartisan stuff. You can't live your life. And my answer to that is, oh, we get to live our lives. Think about the difference, If you're credible, you get to help everybody else decide how they want to show, who they want to advocate for, who they want to vote for, and to be an activist on whatever side they choose. Think of how much power you really have if your stuff is credible. And towards the end of the semester, people go come up to me and say, I just had no idea. And they say, some of us have taken it, we've been in newsrooms, taken it for granted. I think people don't know what goes on in newsrooms. It makes them fascinating places to work. But we got to get that story out. Yeah.
As the media loses its economic base, they go more and more to these think tanks and the Brookings Institute. Cato are really good think tanks. And then go to the Heritage Foundation and get into the propaganda. All under the same name of think tanks. So what are there? Close to 2,000 think tanks? And what are they? Propaganda machines. and yet the media goes to them because they have very talented writers. They have big budgets, and they can hire very talented people, but they're very biased, and we don't see that literally labeled.
Well, I think we should, and you're right. You know, I wouldn't put them all in the same boat. I think some are pretty good, some are, you know, and some are left-leaning, some are right-leaning, and some are better than others, I think. But you're absolutely right, if they're not describing them well and not choosing wisely with what kind of their research they report from them, that's a huge problem. If they're going to, you know, a right or left-leaning think tank to use some of their research, and because they think it's fairly relevant, but they know clearly that it's, this is a traditionally right-leaning think tank, da-da-da-da-da-da, and they're not choosing the ones that have been kind of gadflies and don't do terrible research, but ones that actually have some, they may be coming at it from a certain perspective, but their general research is fairly reliable. And they put it into context that it's right in your left wing, then I think they're okay. It's a little bit the same way with the news talk shows, you know? Not exactly, because they're getting me so used to it. But, you know, and then they're pundit on the right, they're pundit on the left. They sure better tell you what their political position is. Now, frankly, for my taste, just get rid of them and put journalists on there who care about giving us as fair as they can from each side as they see it. I would prefer that. Because, you know, the advocates, the political advocates on each side, they don't even answer the questions. They just have their talking points. It's useless. I think it's useless. I could hardly watch the post-debate stuff. I don't know about other people. Those talking heads. Sorry. I kind of should.
I have here an article that I think the half-truths are probably worse than the all-out untruths. So I was called by a reporter that told me that they had and her heading on this article is groups enter budget battle, nonprofits seeking to change discourse in the budget. And what it really was is a few very liberal left-leaning groups. And when she asked me about the budget, and they had a budget, but it only had three items in their entire state budget. And I said, well, you know that these groups are far left-leaning. And she said, well, yeah, I am aware of that. And then and listed the three items that were their big budget. This is misleading at best, and their groups are not, you know, nonprofits. They're very current activist groups. So that, in my opinion, as an elected official, is a big problem in our country and in our state.
What were the groups?
Citizen Action was one of them. League of Women Voters.
I beg your pardon, but I'm a League of Women Voters member, and we strictly adhere to nonpartisanship, absolutely strictly.
Well, anyway, the Citizen Action one was the one that I pointed out was left-leaning, and she recognized that it was, but didn't indicate that in her article.
It's a question of what she was asking you for. You ask me for a response to them, or
their budget.
I guess I need to know more. But I mean, obviously, people shouldn't misrepresent in how they ask you questions. We're about the truth, and I don't know if they're analyzing the budgets of certain organizations or what. But what we do is we go and find people who know something about it and care about it and ask them to respond a lot of times. And we should be honest about what we're asking. Yeah.
I have a question that maybe sort of relates to the policy for an administration using the term state news doesn't necessarily, I don't think they're saying it to imply that something is not factually reported correct, but rather that the mainstream media is choosing to report on something that shouldn't be important to the public.
You're talking about the Trump administration?
Yes.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, I think there's a separate issue with actual things.
Yeah, I mean, that's what we've got now is because fake news, you know, fake news is such a problem during the election now. Now it's being used to refer to the media every time there's a story that, you know, the administration doesn't like a lot. I'm not trying to be partisan about this. If there are some facts we have to kind of stipulate to, and a lot of things that Trump's saying about the media, I'm sorry, it's just crap. So, yeah, I mean, Breitbart's doing the same thing. It's like every time they see the story, but they don't agree with it, it seems like it's fake news, it's fake news. It's like they picked up on the term and are turning it. So, you know, we're going to have to just deal with that for a while. We're going to keep doing that. We have to make our own decisions about what fake news is. It's, you know, they've also done it when the media has made a mistake. When the guy, the reporter from New York Times, reported wrongly that the Martin Luther King bust had been removed from the White House, they called it fake news. Well, it was an error, which he corrected immediately, right? That's not fake news. Errors are made. Errors are made. That's not the same. So, I mean, that's, the term is now, it's like deliberate obfuscation. Yeah, I wouldn't call that fake news. Unless they're making stuff up to make their point, then that would be fake news. But if they're just giving it, doing a news piece about where they're making moral judgments about policy or something, you know, that's fine. If they're doing that and saying, and you know, and I'm writing this because, you know, 5,000 Trump supporters, you know, murdered people yesterday, that would be a problem. That would be fake news, right? So it's, I think you're right, there's a difference. There's a difference. Yeah.
I'm curious about your opinion. What major mainstream news source propagated, either knowingly or unknowingly, the most fake news in the current election cycle? Again, just your opinion.
I'm not going to give an opinion. I said it would be either fact or not a fact, and I don't want to get it wrong. I don't know. I don't know that. I guess I should know that coming here. I couldn't tell you. I didn't do any measurement of it. Do you know?
Yeah. I just wanted to hear.
You actually wanted me to know.
I
hear
you about Breitbart, so I think you might have an opinion about that.
No, I just don't. Yeah.
So, obviously, CNN and the Trump administration aren't really seeing eye to eye on a lot of things. But I was watching last Wednesday, right after Flynn resigned, and the headline from the New York Times about it was that the Trump administration was in repeated contact with Russia. And then I was watching CNN, and I think it was 9 a.m. in the Central, so 10 a.m. on the East Coast. Their A block, the first headline was CNN, or Trump administration in constant contact with Russia. And then they said constant like 10 times in the first, you know, 15 minutes of the broadcast. Where does that, I was thinking about it, I'm like,
yeah.
I'm not even, you know, over the course of weeks and months, has anyone been in constant contact with anyone else in history, you know? And so I was wondering, like, what are the, and obviously that's pushing a narrative, right? That's pushing, you know, CNN's narrative that, you know, Trump and Russia are working together to overthrow, I don't know, the United States, whatever. But where does that fall in terms of ethics and just that, in that language semantics, that's like a whole nother level of, is this sponsored content, is this all this, it's, you know, language.
You know, in journalism, word choice is really important. And you can find biased words in what I would generally call the legitimate responsible media. You do see it. And there are mistakes in that way. And we talk about this in journalism and in newsrooms, the use of biased words. You know, you can say somebody said something happened, and then you can say somebody claimed something happened. And the word claim is more of a biased word because it suggests that it's just their claim and that may not be true, but somebody said it and it just more has more of a factual connotation. And you got to work on that. And so what does constant mean? That's a vague term, and if it's not explained pretty quickly what you mean by constant, so people can determine whether that's really constant or not, then I would say that's a bad use of the language. If they explained it, how many calls are we talking about among how many people, then that wouldn't be so bad. But without that, and you're shaking your head, it sounds like they didn't, that I think that's not a very, it's too vague of a term. I worked on the investigative project staff at Star Tribune for many years, and we'd have a lot of our stories lawyered. We were doing washout journalism, and we had the stories go through lawyers. And our lawyer used to get on me all the time and say, you use but too much, and it's a biased word. I said, but is it, and they meant B-U-T. Because I'd say, somebody said this, and they go, but this document shows that, you know? And they're saying, you're calling him a liar with that button. I said, no, it's a writing tool to indicate to the reader there's another point of view coming. And they say, no, it's not. It's you making them look like it. And we had a good debate about that, and they were wrong and I'm right. But actually, at least one of my colleagues said, no, they're right, Chris, you use but too much. So I was going to accept it and let him take some off. But yeah, was that being biased? I really take it seriously. I think our credibility is everything. But, you know, it's hard sometimes. That one, they should be careful. Well, we all should be careful. It's part of our job. It doesn't mean what we're doing is fake news. It doesn't mean what we're doing is trying to, you know, hurt anybody or advocate for anybody. But we do, it's easy to make small mistakes. And sometimes we do. Yes.
I'm wondering, you know, you were talking about how sort of everything has been labeled fake news now. And I'm just wondering, where do you think it's going to go? Are we just in a point now where we're never going to have real news again and everything's going to be fake news?
Yeah, great question. Give me an opportunity to put up my last slide, too. I think that's a great question because... I think this is a great opportunity for us because, you know, people finally are having, this stuff's been going on a while in different ways and it's really come to a head right now it seems, but nobody was having this conversation 2 years ago or 10 years ago, right? And suddenly we are. All of a sudden we're stopping and saying, we've got to figure out who we can trust and who we can't trust. And be more active about selecting well. And I think that's great and long overdue. And as you can tell, I think the legitimate, responsible mainstream media gets somewhat of a bad rap, so we have our issues that we need to work on. But they, for the most part, have really good values, like these that almost all adhere to, or try to adhere to, and try to instill in their newsrooms. You see the Society of Professional Journalists Ethics Code on walls all over newsrooms, and you see iterations of it in different ways. And a lot of what is in that long New York Times Echo quote really reflects these things in much more detail. I think, I hope, maybe I'm just kidding myself, that you know the public is going to get better educated and realize that you just can't accept everything that comes across your Facebook page. And you should find a news organization you trust, or two or three or four. And that doesn't mean never look at the other ones, but know what you're looking at and choose for the right reasons. And the part I'm worried about, and I don't know, and I'm not an expert on this, is this whole idea of the echo chamber, and we're just going to continue reading only stuff that reflects what we're here. Because that's no good. That's no good for me, and I catch myself doing it a little bit. You know, we got to work on that. We got to be more willing to let facts lead us to our positions than let our positions lead us to certain facts. I hope that was a little optimistic.
Yeah, what's the balance point between information that, like Snowden and stuff that he thinks should be known by people, and then people who go in and take emails in some place, I don't know if it's illegal or not, but where is the journalist stand on that? Where's the balance point between what is either code of ethics and what isn't?
Yeah, that's a great question, and it's a hard one. I'll tell you what the media is, the good media, sorry, but I keep trying. What it has done in a lot of circumstances is say, is it newsworthy? Does the public have a need to know this? And yeah, it might have been leaked illegally, but now we have it, and we can't ignore it if we think the public needs to know it. But they will balance that, and what they're doing is, and do it all the time, is trying to weigh the truth value against the harm value. So what you saw with a lot of the Snowden stuff and the earlier WikiLeaks stuff was, you know, you see WikiLeaks just throw everything on there and so people can see it. Unethical in my view. Not in everybody's, but in mine. What a lot of news organizations did was they took this stuff and they reported it and they went to the administration and they talked to them about it. In some cases, they were convinced through their reporting that this is a security issue and we should report. And they did. This, not really that much of a security issue, is just embarrassing or it's bad and shouldn't be done anymore. And so we're going to report it. A lot of gray area in there. Probably was a lot of argument over a lot of single documents. But I think they tried to be responsible. But they did not run it just because Snowden shouldn't have leaked it. And this is true with leaks all the time. And there's a lot of conversation now about leaks from the Trump administration and the media salivating over it. And I think they are. But there's discussion about how much of it you should run and how much you should. I think there will be. Just like there was very deliberate discussion about the lie question. A lot of discussion about it. Those can be closed.
Since we're going back some time, if we're looking at, there's a constant struggle between who's controlling the narrative, if we're looking at the government, or looking at journalists. There's a change in the institutions, the economics of news structures, but one of the parts of that government press relation that isn't really talked about very much is the FCC and their fairness doctrine, which they ditched in the early 80s just as cable news is getting started. There's been some arguing for that's one of the reasons behind all of this partisan broadcast that we get from everything from Talking Points Memo to WorldNet Daily, that we should bring back the fairness doctrine. Do you think that might
some of the, I mean, it won't stop the fake news. I mean, Onion's the world's greatest news source. But to...
But we know it's fake.
Yes, but we know it's fake. To kind of tap down that mucky middle.
It's a great question, and I don't know, and I should preface it by saying I'm not much of an expert on the fairness factor, so I got to say that. But I don't know. I don't know that it's going to fix much, and I don't even know how much I think that people should have to worry about that. If you want to, you're weighing it against First Amendment stuff, and I think that's tricky territory. So I'm not sure that's the best way to fix it. I'm not sure it would, and I'm not sure that you don't lose something by doing that. And I don't know how anybody determines whether that somebody would be violating it or not anyway. It's so difficult. So I struggle with that. I think the biggest fix has to be consumer-driven. It's got to be the public. I mean, it's like everything else. We make good choices. And the ones that don't earn our trust don't make it very well. Maybe sorry. Yeah.
On the issue of codes of ethics, safety, truth, and reporting, I discovered that one of the things that is very difficult to do that in the area of the sentiment or the emotion. Assuming you have the opportunity of reporting a news that is directly and that is going to have a negative effect on someone very, very close to you. How do you do it? Are you going to be diplomatic when it comes to that, or are you going to go ahead to report it in this?
Well, if you're talking about a specific story that could hurt somebody close to me, I have to get out of the story because I have a conflict of interest. So, you know, and I've done that and had to do that at times when I have gotten on a story and I find out that, like, one time I remember my family actually had a position on that and had gotten involved in it a little bit, and I said, I got to get out of this story. I have interest and it's going to hurt my credibility. And somebody could, once we write it, could say, well, of course you said that because, you know, your family member does that. So that's classic where people have to make a strong decision to get up, to divorce themselves from the story and let somebody else do it. And we do that a lot. And we do it a lot even if they're just the appearance that you're going to do that. And one of the stories I tell was back during the John Kerry campaign for president, when Bruce Springsteen came to Minneapolis or St. Paul to do a concert, and the proceeds from it were going to go to the Kerry. It was through moveon.org. And St. Paul Pioneer Press told his supporters, you can't go to the Springsteen concert. It's like a fundraiser. It's not exactly a fundraiser. They said, well, we just like Springsteen. We're not going there to give our money to some interest. You know, it's a concert. We go to all the Springsteen concerts. And they said, no, this one's different. You can't do it. And a couple of reporters did, and they got suspended. They appealed it, but through the union. But, you know, I mean, there are a lot of conflicts that we try to avoid. And you have to do that. Yes?
Can you speak to that about enforcing these codes of ethics? So some professions, if you are violating the code of ethics, you get some kind of suspension or you know license renewal. How detailed can it be with journalism? And what's the self-policing process that takes place or should take place with this?
Yeah, that's a great question too. It is self-policing. Pretty much. You don't see a lot of it, frankly, but you see some. I don't know if people remember, well, you remember the Scott Walker recall. A bunch of Gannett found that a bunch of its reporters had signed the recall petition. Or not just reporters, lot of more sports reporters or maybe some copy editors, I think. I don't know how many news reporters there were. But they found a couple dozen or something statewide from different Gannett papers. And, you know, I actually know the editor had to send out the stern memo saying, what the heck are you thinking? Of course we don't do that. I don't know that anybody got in any trouble beyond that, but every once in a while somebody gets suspended for a couple days for something. This guy at the Star Tribune who got in a lot of trouble for tweeting, either tweeted or posted on Facebook, some criticism of an organization that his wife was involved with. And, you know, you can't take a public stance like that. This is an organization we cover and that you might cover sometime. Some kind of disciplinary action. So stuff happens. Often it's a suspension or something. You know, I remember Keith Olbermann. Keith Olbermann got either stepped down under pressure, but got fired for giving money to a Democrat or two. Now, he was the anchor at MSNBC, which everybody assumes everybody's Democratic anyway, right? Well, they had a standard about that. You don't give money to political campaigns, and then he was gone. So big stuff happens sometimes. Some of the policing is a little less. You know, the Star Tribune said you can't go to Springsteen either. Actually, they didn't quite say it. They discouraged people from going to the Springsteen concert. And I had just left there, and I thought, well, what does that say? Either that you're going to let them go or you're not. And I think they just didn't want to know. And I know a guy who's driven to New York to see the Springsteen. He must have gone.
I think on the slide that was about what journalists should do in transparency, it said how they must say what you don't know. Or what?
Yeah, sometimes say what you don't know.
And I wanted to say about that, I remember when I was young and I first noticed journalists doing that on public radio, I thought it was really helpful to help me think more critically about what I was hearing. It just triggered that in me to do it myself more often when I hear something and think, yeah, but we don't know this, we don't know that. But recently I feel like I hear it much more used, especially by panelists, when there's people with more than one position. On a show, then sometimes the host will use it, and it's so clear that what the host mentions that we don't know will influence the listener's opinion to one side or another. It makes me wish that someone else would say, yeah, but we also don't know this, which would be the other side of it. And I just wondered how that's taught in journalism school or whatever.
Probably not well, actually. You know, I've said it, but I don't know how much I guess I've taught it a little bit. I appreciate when, like, a moderator on a show will give us that context. You know, a lot of people saying something, and they're correcting, you know. They're saying, yeah, but we don't quite know that yet, or that the proof's not out on that. That adds information for me, and I don't know if that's what you're talking about. But it's the same way for, an individual reporter to say, we know this, this, and this, and it seems to be leading you to a conclusion. And then they say, but what we don't know is whether they did that on purpose, or whether they did this next thing that proves the quid pro quo, or whatever. And it puts it in context and helps us not rush to judgment ourselves. And the other thing it does is show that it brings credibility to the journalist and the organization by saying, we're not rushing to judgment on this, you know, either. And then you could question, well, maybe they shouldn't report it at all if they don't know that. But sometimes they said, no, these facts need to get out there, and only by reporting them are we most likely to learn more, too, to get the story out and get information back.
Well, it often happens when they're reporting on research.
What's that?
It seems like it often happens when they're reporting on the results of some study or research, and they'll say, this is just a system, and of course, we don't know whether those people were, you know, all from some, they don't tell enough about the study to know whether it
Yeah, I think that's kind of true on a lot of stories about research. I think we don't give enough context like that. So, you know, there are a lot of studies that show that's certainly true on health research, for instance. There's actually an organization that started at the U of M that's not there anymore, but still operating, Health News Review, which critiques news stories on health and shows and kind of calls out bad stories that don't ask enough questions or don't know all the many caveats. And we need to do that in all kinds of our newsroom. This is a big deal in investigative reporting. You know a lot of stuff, it implies something bad. But you know that a little, if you had these other facts, that would prove it. And you don't want to make it look like you have them if you don't. And you want to go beyond that and say that you don't. So people are getting a fair shake here than there. Yeah.
As you're talking about this, it seems to me part of that is due to our short attention spans as Americans. That, I mean, it used to be that, you know, everybody read the National Geographic. And now most of us don't want to invest that kind of time in that long of an article. You know, and I know I find myself doing it. It's a lot easier to read that blurb that comes across from, you know, BuzzFeed or whoever than it is to go read an article from The Atlantic. You know, so how do we balance that? And do you have sources that you would recommend, you know, on a kind of different, you know, here's quick news that's at least accurate and, you know, that gives you the quick points, but is as accurate as they can be in a short span, versus here's a good in-depth if you want more information.
Yeah, I'm busy, everybody's busy. And I love The Atlantic, it's awful good. it depends. You know, what we haven't been really talking about very much is our local news. Newspaper, local TV station, local radio stations, which, you know, local news is where you can really have an influence, by the way. If we're talking about national news, I will just tell you, I think the New York Times and Washington Post are two great newspapers in the world, and I know some people have different opinions about that, but I'm not going to apologize for it. They do great work, and their journalists are incredible. I've known a few of them. A lot of times I'll try to catch what I can from them, and I don't have time to read all of them or even all those stories, but I can get a pretty good sense pretty quickly. On my iPad, I get the New York Times morning briefing piece, and if I want to read about, you know, quick national update, I can get to that pretty fast. You know, your bigger metro papers, I mean, I don't know how you live in Minneapolis, I'll read Star Tribune, and I don't know how you can live around here without listening to public radio. Full disclosure, my wife is a news director at Minnesota Public Radio, but I've been listening to public radio since I was in college, and I think it's incredible. So that's why I'm a mainstream media guy. I think those are incredible. We're lucky. What we don't realize is we're pretty lucky. I'm not saying they don't make mistakes. I'm not saying that. I'm not saying there are areas they can do better. But there are news organizations that we trust that try to give us both sides, that really work hard at it, but also try to call a spade a spade. And those are important values.
I'm going to guess you that you would say during your time at the Star Tribune that there was good separation between writers and the sales department.
We never do.
My question would be, do you think that that's still true today? That when I hear a story that CNN might use the word like constant in the headline, do you think that that is because there's not enough separation between the writers and the sales department that much of our headlines and whatnot are to drive sales or drive clicks?
Yeah, it's, you know, I'm not going to say that there's not a connection, because frankly, there's a lot of worry about staying afloat these days. And so, and especially with the web, where you know exactly what everybody's reading every minute. You can track that. And, you know, that can be a problem. We know what the most read stories are, right? Man bites dog, Sid Hartman, the Vikings, the Pack, or here the Packers, you know. I'm a Wisconsin guy myself, the Packers for me. We know what people read, and they see those clicks, and those sell ads, and so they are influenced by them. And the good places try to balance that and try to say, yeah, I know, so let's put them over here so people can get them, but let's make sure we have a good spot for the more important stuff, even if it doesn't get read quite as much, yada, yada, yada. But, so there's influence in that way. Most of the reporters couldn't care less. A lot of the editors, they're going to create a headline, though, that has good search engine optimization so that it'll get found on Google, you know, it'll show up on Facebook. That can influence headline writing. Some stuff can get a little, maybe more probably, can get a little more sensational than it should. So there are issues there. But it's not so bad as, you know, Macy's is a good advertiser, let's write nice stuff about Macy's. I never had a story killed because of an advertiser in my 22 years at two papers. That helps. I'm not saying it doesn't happen. I think it has happened. It's pretty rare.
Thank you. I've heard it said that some reporters do not vote in order to maintain their impartiality. Mm-hmm. Is that the case, and is that recommended?
Oh, this becomes a great discussion in my ethics class. Students are appalled that I would suggest that maybe that should happen sometime. The former editor of the Washington Post did not vote and made a public declaration that he would not vote because he felt it, at least, he didn't use the word objectivity, but he felt it put him in a better position to not worry about where he was on candidates. So that he could just focus on covering them. I appreciate that. There were some times, I will say, when I covered politics, and I didn't cover, you know, politics on a daily basis a lot in my career, but for a couple of years, year or two, I did. There were a couple times there when I didn't vote. I just didn't think that. I just thought about covering it. And I think that's okay. What I always say is, if you're doing your best to be impartial, knowing it's an imperfect thing, if you're doing your very best and you're training yourself with the discipline to do it as well as you can, you know, and I've chased Democrats and Republicans. I mean, as a journalist, though. you have incredible power. And who cares about my one vote? I mean, I know. Everybody should care about their one vote. I get that. But, you know, I think if you're covering politics, I get it. I think there's if you weigh the benefits of having the most credibility possible and doing the best job possible covering politics against your one vote, hey, this is pretty convenient. So I get that. I never tell my students that they shouldn't vote. I would never tell somebody in my newsroom not to vote. As an appreciation, people who don't want to.
That does come under discussion.
It does. I don't think any newsroom ever suggests that people should. But there are people in newsrooms who don't. You don't vote.